commencer. Bonsoir à tous et à toutes. Au nom de l'école d'architecture, je suis très content d'accueillir Adrien Ravon ce soir pour une conférence donc, sur le laboratoire Y Factory. Et remercier Emmanuel Rombach et Sandro Varano et Olivier Poula, donc l'équipe qui a organisé l'accueil d'Adrien Ravon dans le cadre donc, de ce séminaire, de ce workshop commun entre l'école d'architecture et Mumbai, dont je me réjouis puisqu'on en avait discuté longuement ensemble et je suis très content que ça puisse avoir lieu. Et j'en profite pour souhaiter la bienvenue aux étudiants indiens qui sont parmi nous. Décidément, en ce moment, on est très international. On a l'exposition Oran qui va ouvrir bientôt. Et donc, on vous accueille de Mumbai. C'est tout à fait intéressant et dynamique. Et je m'en réjouis pour l'école. Voilà, je laisse la parole à Emmanuel pour présenter le travail de Adrien. Merci.
Bonjour, donc effectivement nous avons la chance d'accueillir aujourd'hui mais aussi demain Adrien Ravon dans le cadre d'un workshop qui associe donc l'ENSAS, l'Institut d'architecture et d'urbanisme de Mumbai, avec lequel nous avons donc passé une convention pour 3 années de suite, ce qui nous amène à travailler donc avec nos collègues indiens dans le cadre de workshops intensifs. Nous sommes donc allés 10 jours à Mumbai et donc là nous accueillons donc les étudiants indiens pour finir un travail de projet intensif sur 6 sites prélevés sur le contexte indien. Et dans ce cadre effectivement où nous avons travaillé à partir d'une thématique très, très importante en Inde qui est celle de la densité associée à une problématique qui est celle du logement, sachant qu'aujourd'hui effectivement beaucoup d'Indiens n'ont pas de logement abordable, confortable pour pouvoir se loger. La ville de Mumbai, c'est une ville d'environ 20 millions d'habitants et environ plus de la moitié des logements sont des logements informels de type slum. Donc cette problématique, évidemment, nous concerne vivement avec nos collègues indiens. Et donc dans le cadre de cet atelier, nous avons choisi également d'associer un outil un peu particulier qui est un outil paramétrique que nous avons découvert il y a 5 ans à The Y Factory grâce à l'invitation de Unimas dans le cadre d'un workshop organisé avec l'ENSAS. Et donc c'est dans ce cadre que nous avons rencontré Adrien qui effectivement travaille dans ce laboratoire depuis environ 7 ans et qui développe des recherches mais aussi des modules pédagogiques très innovants qu'il va nous présenter ce soir. Donc je vais lui laisser la parole. La conférence sera donnée en anglais pour que nos amis indiens puissent la suivre et j'espère que pour nos amis français ce sera plutôt sympathique d'avoir une conférence en anglais pour une fois. Voilà, je te laisse la parole, Adrien.
Hello, hello. Do you hear me? Okay, so it's going to be in English, but still with a French accent. Thanks for the introduction. Thanks for the invitation, Emmanuel and Sandro. That's very good to be back here at ENSAS. And to be back in this frame of this workshop with our colleagues from Mumbai. So I will introduce to you the Y Factory, which is so that's the title of the conference: Research, Education, and Public Engagement. Which is basically this research think tank. Which is based at TU Delft, a public university in the Netherlands. So basically, that's first of all a physical place, this orange tribune that you can see, where we experiment, we research, we collaborate, and we want to bring argumentation back to architecture. So that's, our physical place. But the Y Factory is also a traveling entity where we collaborate with our network of universities, so we travel. Like recently, we had a collaboration with GSAP New York, Bezalel, YAC, AEDES, or RMIT Melbourne coming to Delft next semester. So the Y Factory is, first of all, Winnie Maas, our professor. He's the co-founder of the architecture practice MVRDV, but he's also the director of the Wi-Fi Factory, this research think tank. And that's also a team of teachers, researchers, editors, graphic designers, scripters, with whom we work. So how did it start? It started when a decade ago, when we was appointed professor at TU Delft, and basically decided to bring the research part of the research undertaken at MVRDV to the TU Delft. So MVRDV is well known for its architecture, like for example the Market Hall, but is also or was also well known for the research, like MetaCity, Dataton, PharmaX, or research on Olympic Games, or Skycar, or CityPig, and the Space Fighter. So that's what basically Winnie decided to bring to TU Delft, and that's what we want to continue, where we combine basically research and education, and we do that with our design studio. So research and education are really the same thing for us. We don't make this distinction. And our main agenda, what do we do, what do we look at? We look at future cities. So we want to look at the future of the cities because we think the future city is wide, because we think as architects, we have to be optimistic about the future. We need to look at the future city tomorrow, in 10 years, 50 years, 100 years, and 200 years. And we want to keep on building architectural myths. So we want to trigger imagination because we think that the future city is wonderful. Can we dream big? Can we revisit Boulez architecture, for example, with this ball where the city is seeing its own reflection in this monumental building? Or for example, this colossus up in the sky that could have been maybe another kind of World Trade Center. We think that the future city is infinite, and yes, it's transparent. So we dream about this city where you can see through building, everything will be made of glass, and where you can see the horizon from anywhere. It's infinite because it's self-reflecting, like for example this vision of a city made of mirrors. It's infinite because it's constantly bright, like for example this project from a student with those lamps, with those suns following you and lighting up whenever you need it. It's infinite because it's safe. So for example, nowadays, how many elements in the city are about safety and only about safety? So we dream about this vision of a city where you don't have any handrails, any barriers, and everything will be safe. We think that the future city is fast, and it's fast and accessible, and that we could potentially reach any point in the city within 4 minutes from anywhere on the globe, but also on the neighborhood, and that you could accelerate and slow down when needed. We think that the future city is green, like for, and we need some sustainable energy. So how can architecture and technology participate to that and can play a role in it, like for example with those lily pads catching the sunlight and the energy? Or for example, how can we turn the canals of Amsterdam into blue light where algae could catch the sun, the sunlight during the day and light up during the night to create this kind of feric atmosphere. We think that the future city is absolute leisure and that leisure is everywhere. Like for example, with this vision, or what would happen if we would all have access to a waterfall? How would it look like? What kind of climate could that generate? Or if we all want courtyards in our city, how would such a city look like? If we all want a view to the sea, the whole world would be completely different. So we want to visualize scenarios. Or for example, if we all want this Miss van der Rohe patio replica, how would that look like with this infinite horizon? We also think that the future city is biodiverse and where animals and plants would have the same place as human, where we could like welcome different species, a maximum of species, instead of chasing them. And we could create different microclimates And you could potentially welcome parrots and tigers inside the city. How would that work? Would that be possible? So the whole city would become something completely wild. And we have this question, where animal will be welcome, how much maintenance would you need? Do you need any maintenance of the city? Or can animals help to that? So we think the future city is also compact. Yes, it's individual, it's informal, and it's intense. Like, for example, this project, Vertical Village. So it's dense, but it can also be intimate and human scale still. And be denser while keeping the village's qualities in a very dense context. We also think that the future city is porous and the future cities are open with pockets for encounter, with terraces to meet and balconies, with more light, more air to breathe, more ventilation, and where you can see through those buildings, and buildings will not obstruct anymore sunlight. We think that the future city is egoistic and it's compact. So we all have to live together in a mixed, dense, and diverse context where we are all different but living together. How to negotiate then with your neighbor, how to live together. We also think that the future city is adaptable and that it could be like fully adaptable environment where your space will constantly change to accommodate your desires. And would that be more ergonomic? And how would your neighbor react if you would extend your room and if you push him away? So basically, we are calling all the visionaries to join us, to fantasize, to dream about the future city, and to test different scenarios. So we make books. We make those visions, we make those research, but we make books. That's one thing. So we have this series of books, which is called the Future City Series. Because, why do we do that? Because we want to share, let's say, our research finding with others. We don't want to keep our research inside the faculty, which is often the case. And we want to also share that with a broader audience and also with non-architects. So this is our ambition. We have a series of topics we want to explore. This is where we are. That's one book per year. And we also do exhibitions. To engage, like for example, the Vertical Village, because we want to engage the public to debate and to take part to those visions of the future and to discuss those future products. So we want to the public to participate to research, like for example, during this masterclass, where we're inviting citizens of Eindhoven to discuss about the future of Eindhoven. We want everybody to be part of it. Like, for example, during the Dutch Design Week recently in Eindhoven, where we were projecting all our research on this 20 meters long screen, so that you could have your coffee looking at the future cities and vision of the future cities, and even children would take part to that. So we also have clear methodologies that we are constantly refining. And it starts by asking questions. We ask questions from now to then about the future, because there are so many futures possible, so many trends, so many urgencies, so many desires. So what is the future city we want? That's what we ask. We produce visions, visualizing scenarios. We will start with a scenario, producing a vision, and going from the vision to the project. To do that, we develop some models, because yes, it's complex. Future cities and cities are complex. So we want to map this set of interrelations to understand certain behaviors and to be able to measure the impact of different scenarios, to visualize all this data that we produce and be able to understand what will be the different impacts of those scenarios. So we have this certain degree of abstraction. Usually we don't start with a specific context, but more with a set of parameters and with this abstract model. We make tools. Yes, we use scripting. We work a lot with Grasshopper. Yes, we need computers to calculate. Yes, we need models to simulate, test, and get feedback about those scenarios. And yes, we want to be able to interact with those models. So we look at those things. And finally, we test applications with this abstract model, testing those abstract models on different sites, like for example here in Barcelona, where the Green Dream, even Gaudi, could be part of this vision. So what's next? That's a question we constantly ask ourselves. That's a question Winnie is constantly asking. And that challenges us constantly to move forward. So I will now present you four projects. And I would like to start with copy-paste, and especially one chapter, which is a chapter based on a workshop when Emmanuel and Sandro came to Delft. So it's called Copy-Paste, the Badass Architectural Copy Guide. So what is it about? It's a book about copy and evolution, and about this obsession of the architect to be original and unique. So we talk about new, what is new, we all claim to be new. We talk about different generations, we talk about similarities in architecture, we talk about copyright, and locase, we talk about originality, tools, speed, and architecture DNA. Because we all have the sensation of déjà vu with buildings. So, for example, who was first? What's the relation between these buildings in this city of icons? So we started to sort those icons, trying to understand what's their relation, what are their resemblances. And we were looking at that outer shape to propose this tree of species as one way of looking at those shapes. So we did this project and this chapter called Generator on the origin and evolution of species. So basically looking at all those different families of architecture and tracing resemblances. And for this, we started to look at tools and, for example, and especially the 3D modeling tools like Rhino, 3ds Max, etc. And if you look at the primitive shapes they are offering, they are mostly all the same. Then we were looking at those toolbars that those softwares are offering, and they are also all the same. So we were asking ourselves the question of how those tools are conditioning ourselves and what kind of potential do they offer. Then we were looking at the ancestors, like those primitive platonic solids, and looking at this set of transformations that the 3D modeling software like Twist, Bend, Rotate, Scale, Mirror, etc. And then we were looking at this, trying to reveal the DNA of and this evolution of a cube, for example. And doing that, we started to generate a pool, like an infinite library of codes, of sequences of gene code, with this tool Grasshopper, where we could trace any DNA of any shape. So for example. So basically, the generator is something constantly generating new sequences and testing and testing and testing options. And that's something which is constantly mutating, transforming, evolving, where species would evolve. Some would die and disappear. And speculating on this artificial intelligence scenario and how fascinating it is and how, let's say, this fear of losing control or being copied is in our discipline. So let me continue then with a project which is called Porosity, which was my first project at the Y-Factory, Pixel Power. So that's a project illustrating quite well our methodology and our approach to Grasshopper and parametric software. So welcome to a porous society, welcome to a society that wants to be open. Why porous? Because we think that was the hypothesis that porous is more, that porosity can bring more light. We all talk about porosity, but what is it exactly? So it can bring more light, it can bring more views, it could bring more streets and circulations and pathways, more mixity of programs, more balconies and terraces, more public place for encounters, more void, of course, more topography, more roof and more passages and more in-between space, more ventilation and space for green and for different climates. And we did that because starting with this idea that towers are stupid. They are stupid because they are enclosed, because you get in, you go up, you go down, and that's it, and end of the story. They are often like very, only a pure extrusion. So we were looking at how can we open up those towers. That was our challenge. And we did that when we received roughly 1 million Lego blocks. And that was our material to work with during several semesters. And basically where we wanted to open the towers. So how to do that? That was the first opening act, where with one Lego box, you could make propose a tower that is more porous, more open. And then we started to produce with students this sequence of transformation, this step-by-step approach of how can we, and those different families of how can we open up those towers, like you saw the belly, the split, the tunnels, and so on. And this led for the midterm to a matrix of transformation from enclosed to open of different families of transformation of those towers made out of Lego blocks. So why were we working with Lego blocks? Because then you can quantify, you can count how many Lego blocks do you have in each tower, for example, which one is more open than the other one. So hard to quantify, hard to evaluate. So we had this army of block, this kind of vision, where we could speculate if, for example, Manhattan, you would walk through Manhattan, and step by step, it would open up, transform into a ball, melt, or the parasite, or the bubbles, or the polite tower, or the cascades, or the cornflake, the belly again, and basically this sequence, step by step, opening up. So after that, we wanted to continue, and we did a parametric approach that we call the porosity maker, because we started to see from the Lego towers, from this analogical approach, we started to see the value of and the potential of translating this knowledge into a parametric approach. So based on different inclinations, you would get more or less public or private terraces and balconies. So that's how we started, for example, with the landscapes, where you would take one envelope. We all had the same envelopes. You would split these towers into different neighborhoods, check if sunlight could get in, and then define some control points to those different plateaus and different platforms, and then start to work to increase the landscape of each plateau and increase the topography. So that's what we did from Alps to Hollande, from a very high, very intense topography at bottom to get more sunlight to a flat one on the top, in Hollande. Then by extruding, we would look for some connections between those different plateaus for circulation. And we gathered all this knowledge into this tool to create different ways of opening up the towers, and to be able to generate any kind of open towers based on those different families we were proposing with those Legos, by doing that step by step, seeing when it was what would be, let's say, the breaking point. So and to translate that back into Lego with those towers of 2.5 meters high, like for example the landscape here or the stairs again. Again, another version of the landscape, creating some grottos, different grain size, the diamonds, the voids, and to produce this kind of collective outcome of the studio. So that's also something, at the end, you don't know who did what. That's something we all did together with the students as a group. So we all had the same envelope so that we could compare those results. So at the end, this is becoming kind of collective work, collective exhibition that has been and keep on traveling. The evaluation, because that was, let's say, generative part. We were looking at ways of opening up the towers, but how can we evaluate? How can we be a bit more systematic and, let's say, and understand why one tower would be more open than the other? Why, for example, this is more porous than this one, or this one, or this one? And And for this, that's what we call the pixel power, how the pixel can help us as a Lego blocks that we could count, could help us to count how many blocks do we have, how the pixel could help us to quantify this porosity. So basically, we could look how many faces are open, how many terraces do you have, how much sunlight do you get, and how much steel do you need to build that up. So we looked, we took this voxel as our unit of measurement for those towers to understand what are the benefits of being of having a more porous and open design, terraces, view, daylights, but at the same time, what are the costs? So we did another studio where we wanted to look at the structure and how much does it cost to open up, basically, or to bend in that case. So that's what we did, comparing the cost versus benefits, seeing when it was becoming too expensive, for example, and when when it will become decent again. So this allowed us to define a method to evaluate any kind of pixelated and abstracted model to understand which one is the most porous, which one has more view, which one has more terraces, which one has more daylight and sunlight. So what's next after that? Well, yes, we need robots. We need robots to build up those towers with Lego, to stack Lego blocks. Because we were doing that with our students, we are basically building this tower of 2.5 meter high. Was taking 2 weeks, working days and nights. So how robots could help in this enterprise? So I will move on with another project. And just get a sip of water, sorry. So, after working with Lego, we started to work with Barba, life in a fully adaptable environment. So that's another project that is also illustrating our methodology, where we were starting with this speculation, with this fascination for new materials and nanotechnologies, speculating what would happen if we would have a material that could adapt, transform a micro particle that could take any shape, that could connect and disconnect, that could make a flat surface, that could expand, that could overlap, that could potentially change temperature, change luminosity, that could start to make solid shapes and gather together, that could start to make tubes, that could become rigid or soft and start to move and create some waves. And basically, this was our inspiration. I guess you know them all, the Barba Papa. And basically, we were interested in this kind of sequence. How can we do that with those materials? And asking ourselves, would this house still be the same, still look with this pitch roof, if we would have this magical material? So from science to fiction and vice versa. So we were looking at Barba Papa, but we were also looking at research, more serious researches that are still taking place in different universities in the world. For example, with this programmable sand or those micro robots that could attach and detach, or this self-assembly lab at MIT. And we started to dream, we started to look at how would it look like to live in such an environment. How would that happen if you would wake up one day surrounded by this material that could start to breathe with you, following your heartbeat, that you would wake up, and this material will understand that you are waking up. The material could potentially push you up so that you can stand, and you would start to explore your environment. So asking the question also of this, what's this minimum space? How much space do I need? What's, let's say, this comfort zone? So you would start to explore just by looking at, and you would extend your space. You want to see what's happening outside of this bubble. So just by one gesture, you could create potentially a window that will not entirely look like that. Then, let's say my cousine will come with his dog, and we would like to meet, and hop, we will merge together into the same bubble. Then I will need a sink to wash my hands, and some veins will bring water, and my cousine will need a different kind of sink because it's shorter. And then you will trust this environment, this magical environment, you will trust it so badly that you could jump blindly, and you will be sure that it's safe enough and that this environment would welcome you. And you will start to discover this pool in this cave. So that's also the question, who is moving then? I am swimming, is that the material around me swimming? Your cousin will join you, and you would, detach again. And then suddenly from your huge swimming pool to a bath, you will transform into a shower. Question about clothes, what's the future of clothes and fashion if we have this magical material? How would you dress up? And so on. How would you cook? Another question, what about food in this constantly transformable environment? How do I cook pasta? Can you boil some water? Can this material start to boil up? How would your room look like, and how could it adapt based on your different, let's say, activities? And when you need space or you don't need, how can we be more ergonomic? How can we be more compact, have less space, and suddenly you would lay back, and so on. So that's again this idea of step-by-step transforming environment where you can move from this to that, this matrix-like momentum where the material is up, surrounding you and creating some clothes, where one day you want to have a shirt and the other day a t-shirt, and you would, let's say, you could desire whatever you want, so you could, in this dream, have this feeling of immensity, like in your swimming pool. But this you could do until your neighbor is coming. And when your neighbor is coming, you have to negotiate. You have to, compromise. You have to shrink, or you have to push back. How does that work? How does that work if my neighbor wants to have a view and extend it like that? Is it going through my house? Or when I'm sleeping, when I'm not at home, or for example, I'm not in Rotterdam, what about my apartment? Can it shrink? Or for example, this vision, where we would all have, different activities simultaneously, and we could negotiate. And have this vision of a constantly transformable city. What are the implications? Is that a dream or is that a nightmare? What about consciousness? What about how do I know where I am? What about ownership? And so many questions. What about regulations? So all these scenarios was helping us also to ask ourselves some questions about the city, even if it's a far-fetched scenario, was helping us to ask ourselves some questions about the city of nowadays. How do we negotiate with neighbors? What about ownership? And so on. So, okay, just I have a bit more time. So basically, we wanted to continue after this vision, and we did so we wanted to look at how can we create, let's say, this minimal space. So we started to look at the body, at the human body, and we started to look at Neufahrt and how, let's say, similar those drawings by Neufahrt were from this animation we were creating, where step by step you would transform. And how can we be more ergonomic, or this idea of comfort. So to do that, we were inspired by this photograph, Muybridge, and we wanted to, revisit his work using Kinect that can track, your body motion, and how much space do I need, and how long my space, needs to fade away. So we were doing different actions with legs here, testing the Kinect. And based on that, we were trying to define what's the minimum space do I need, how much space do I need to breathe, how much space do I need for my movement, and how, when is it comfortable enough. So that's what we call the halo maker, the halo, and how can we, then sculpt and interact with this space. So we did a series of interactive models where we could start to experience, how do I negotiate with my neighbor, can I push the wall like that? how would he react? So we were trying to, let's say, get a feeling, an experience of this kind of negotiation. These questions, can we live with zero wasted space? And how much material would I need so that it will become stable enough? I will not show you the last part. We continued with other experiments about how can we start to build that, how can we start with, let's say, with physical models, how can we simulate, and how can we start to build the Barba Papa. But I will move to another project, and that will be the last one, which is very much related to this Barba dream, which is called WeGo, tailor-made housing. So we were looking at this Barba constantly transformable dream homes and this negotiation between those different desires. So we started with a project called Vertical Village, where we would go from a standard block to a more, let's say, a collection of dream homes and more individualistic pile of houses. So how can we, let's say, start to pile them up, those very different houses, to create this idea of, to preserve those qualities of villages. How can we do that? We wanted to go further with a studio called Ego City. So we started with focusing on the ego, where we asked the students to produce a series of dream homes. And we were asking the same questions. How compact can we be? How dense can we be? So we were looking at different densities. How can we fit, let's say, 17 dream homes inside a predefined envelope? So we were looking at different densities, pick the slab as an option. Sorry for that. And how do we then negotiate? How do we fit, let's say, how 17 egos will fit their desires inside a this predefined envelope. So we asked the students to fantasize about a hypothetical client, an hypothetical ego. So we had Marilyn Manson and some crazy ones. Desperate housewife, she wanted a pitch roof and a garden. We had someone who wanted to live in a roller coaster. We had the bibliomaniac, he just wanted to, let's say, collection more books and more books. We had the athlete, Usain Bolt, with, let's say, a series of facilities for sport. We had Kevin McAllister, he just wanted a series of games and a playground. And we had the dude, our favorite one. This one just wanted a bowling alley and an elevator, because he's lazy and he likes to play bowling. So how do we do that? How do we, let's say, how do we go denser and more compact as just stacking them up? And what's, let's say, the consequences of that? What kind of conflict can we, let's say, can we expect from this densification act? And how can we solve those conflicts? Do we compromise? If we talk, if we discuss, we did one afternoon where the students were discussing and trying to find solutions together, and at the end they were like way too kind with each other, and they were like compromising too much. So the win-win was becoming like going back to the standard and to a kind of statu quo. Do we fight? Well, not really. Or can we do a game? And of course, we went for that option, where the students decided to develop a video game so that they could start to negotiate and fit their, let's say, dream homes inside this envelope. So for this, we did different game strategies, like the blind game, for example, where you couldn't see what your neighbor would be doing, the trading, where you could still exchange some space with your neighbor, the automatic game, and so on. So for example, the blind game, we did that with Rhino and Grasshopper again, where the students were developing this script and starting to develop this game, where they could simultaneously, 17 students together, start to, let's say, fit their dream home, starting from their needs, let's say from the basic elements, toilet, kitchen, etc., and then starting to fit their desires, like bowling alley, tower, and so on. So that's how one was starting, for example. the other ones were also starting simultaneously, and how we would start to conquer and claim, let's say, those pixels so that you could fit your dream home. And then we looked at, we wanted to understand if, let's say, those egos were satisfied enough. So we started to look at different ways of mapping this evaluation, this degree of satisfaction. Which one? What would be, let's say, the overall degree of satisfaction of this slab? And knowing that this is just one frozen moment where the game could have gone on forever, but at some point we started to say we have to freeze and to look at these models. For example, the dude asking his bowling alley. And how can we, let's say, look at volume, if he has enough volume, if the shape is respected, if the position he wanted, if he wanted to be on the ground floor, or let's say more to on the top of the of this slab, if he's still happy with that. So he's way smaller, but still he has this vertical element, this horizontal element, so a certain degree of satisfaction. So that's what we did a few times, several times, trying to understand the potential of this game and basically what kind of outcomes we could generate with this negotiation process. And this is, for example, you have on the top the dream home, the original dream home, and here the outcome type of apartment. And that was quite interesting because all those, let's say, apartments, we couldn't design them beforehand. So they are like something that we couldn't expect and that come out after this negotiation process from which the architects were, let's say, a spectator and just watching this negotiation process. And all those typologies, which are not so bad, actually, in most of the cases, but that were completely unexpected. And this led to, let's say, one result, which is this frozen moment, where, yes, we can be denser, that's, let's say, our hypothesis, where you can have, let's say, the bibliomaniac next to the other, and how would that work? I mean, there are a lot of things that are not solved yet about acoustic, about circulation, about piping, and infrastructure. So that's also what we are looking at in the next step. And yes, we can be more compact, we can be more unique to compose this mosaic of desires, where we started from ego to we go, and basically we're being together, being compact, would bring more qualities. So after that, we wanted to go further and to do, let's say, a one-to-one scale model. So we wanted to see how does that work if we want to build it one-to-one. So that's again one of the pavilion we did at the Dutch Design Week last, 1 month ago, which is a WeGo hotel. So where basically you have 9 rooms, so inspired by this project, where you would have 9 rooms and 9 hotel rooms and with 9 doors, and everyone would have his own mailbox and his own door and his own access. And basically you would, let's say, pick one door and climb up and discover your hotel room for one night. And you would up. Get your bed, get your shower, get your toilet, and be in this room, which will be like 9 meters high in some cases, only one stair in another one, a tribune in another one, the billboard for the other one, or the botanic garden in the other one. So what's next after that? What do we do? Well, we want to do what we don't know how to do yet. So what's happening when, let's say, one of those clients is going outside of this WeGo hotel? What's happening when you have more clients suddenly? One night you have only 9 clients, but the day after you should be able to accommodate 24 clients. How can we do that? How can technology help us to do that? How can we have, let's say, this those planks moving and reconfigurating to accommodate more or less users and different facilities? And how can it be safe enough That's a question we want to investigate in the next step. So yes, basically that's again an invitation of going out of our comfort zone of what we know how to do, and to look for other other options. And how can we be more compact, more diverse, more open, more intimate, more flexible, and more mixed? So yeah, that's it for the presentation. There is so much to do. So if you have questions, ideas, and topics you would like to discuss, I'm more than happy to try to answer to that or to discuss that in a more casual way. Sorry.
For the film, thank you, Adrien, for this very interesting lecture. I think that the main question is for me the question of the generosity. The question of the public space, the collective space in a context, in a time of the densification and the individualization at the same time of everything. And I think that it is perhaps an European attitude that we have to defend.
Yes, indeed, I see that's correct. But at the same time, there are so many things to learn from others, like for example, you're just coming back from India, and with the things we saw this afternoon, so many, let's say, so much knowledge and so much examples and case studies that from which we could learn from. So yes, I mean this idea of densification, while preserving certain qualities or while preserving the human scale. Is something definitely we have to defend. Yeah.
Have you some question or ideas to share with us, with Adrien?
No. If you prefer more casual way, we can also meet upstairs.
Okay. Thank you very much for your attention. And thank you, Adrien.
Thanks.